Hi and welcome to this video on GNSS technology and coordinate systems. This video will make you understand how GNSS works, that is also sometimes referred to as GPS, and it will make you understand why choosing the correct coordinate system is imperative when working at a job site with 3D machine control installed on machines. So, Anders Forsell, how would you describe GNSS or satellite navigation?
Well, GNSS, or as many people say, GPS. First, we can just explain the difference there. GPS, that is just one of the providers of satellites to the GNSS solution. GNSS, that is a proper name, and that is Global Navigation Satellite System. And I actually put together a small PowerPoint. I think it's easier to explain it from here.
Let's have a look at it.
So, GNSS, that is a Global Navigation Satellite System. It consists of four different satellite systems, where GPS is just one of them, and that is the American system. We have also the GLONASS, which is a Russian variation of the same thing. Galileo, which is a European solution. And finally, we got Beidou. So these four providers, they provide a solution with satellites covering the whole world. The satellites are, let's say, rotating around the globe in different orbits. And the receiver on the machine or on your rover pole or even in your car as your navigation system is receiving information from these satellites to calculate where the position is of the device.
So obviously, when we talk about navigation in car system and stuff like that, we have an accuracy of approximately 1 meter, a couple of meters, something like that. For obvious reason, when we're talking about construction purposes, we need a higher accuracy. How do we achieve that?
So the way we sort that out is a technology that is called RTK, which is real-time kinematics or real-time cinematics. It consists of a solution where we have a base station. So that is one GNSS receiver set up over a known point. Then we've got the rovers, which could be either the surveying pole or the machine. Both of these units are receiving information from the same satellites. The base station knows its exact position, where it is, while the rover doesn't. Since we know the exact position of the base, we can calculate the deviation between the satellite calculation of the position of the base with its known position. And that deviation or difference in position is sent either via Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or radio or via the telephone network, doesn't matter, but in any way, it's transferred from the base station to the machine rover. Mm-hmm. And in the machine rover, there's a recalculation where it takes again the satellite information and recalculates it with the correction information from the base. And that will provide it with an accuracy of within a couple of centimeters.
So basically what the system does, the machine control solution installed on the machine, it gets a rough position from the satellite and then it gets a deviation information from an RTK source. And these two things are combined into one calculation, which is the high accuracy.
Yeah, a bit simplified, but that's the principle behind it, yes.
And how fast does it work?
Immediately. So we send corrections every second. But the calculation is done in a millisecond in the receivers. So it's very, very immediate.
What are the requirements for this to work?
Well, first of all, since the RTK calculation is based on satellites that are in common, so you need to have the same satellites in the base station as in the rover. That means that the base station has to be set up in a location where you got as good sky visibility as you ever can.
So as high as possible?
Not necessarily as high, but at least as free as possible. So no obstructions nearby, not close to a wall, for example. Because the base we can be in control of where we put it up, but the machine, it has to work where it has to work. So if we will end up in a situation or a scenario where the machine has to work close to a building or maybe close to a forest or anywhere where it's like kind of covering or getting limitations of the sky, we only want that limitation to happen in the rover. So if we, for example, receive 10 satellites in the base, we can also have 10 satellites in the machine. But if it's only 7 of these satellites that are exactly the same satellites that are in common, it will only be the 7 satellites that will be calculating the position.
How many satellites do you need to calculate a position?
You mean minimum 5. Basically everything more than that is good, but if you have 17 or 19, that doesn't mean that you have a better position than if you had 10, for example.
Cool, so a clear line of sight between the base station and the sky, that's a clear requirement.
Yeah, great. And also some kind of radio communication between the base and the rover.
So now we have established the position of the machine or the rover, whatever it is that you're working with right now. How do we put that on the geographical correct spot?
It's done in a couple of several calculations. For example, the satellites, they're working in a coordinate system that is adapted to the globe, which is kind of circular. But in many cases, the design we're using is flat. So we need to do a kind of recalculation between a circular surface to a flat surface. And the example I have here, I basically compared with an orange. So if you consider the globe as being an orange, so when you peel the shell off of the orange, it's very, very difficult to get it absolutely flat. And this is the calculation that needs to be done in the background to get a position accurate enough for you to be projected on the globe. And the way we do it is that we need to have flat coordinates. So a coordinate system that is matching the existing surface has to be recalculated based on the satellite coordinate system. So what we do is that we are projecting the map to the, or the design to the globe. We are reading the northing, easting, and height with lat long. So lat long, northing, lat long, easting, and lat long height, together with a localization, which is a calculation that is done to convert the coordinates. And by, well, the end result of that is a log file, which is the same thing as a coordinate system to be used on site for our equipment.
And this is where it is really important that you make sure that the coordinate system that you select in the machine, in the panel for the machine, it is the exact same coordinate system as we use for creating the file.
Exactly, because the design is already made in a predefined, decided coordinate system. So the all data on the design is adapted to that coordinate system. Our machines has to work in that coordinate system. And if you, let's say, have more than one coordinate system to select between, you will most likely be mismatching your position if you pick the wrong one. Sometimes it's only the height that will vary, but most likely with both the height and also the location in northing and easting that will be an which will have an impact.
So basically what we need to have this to work, we need to have access to satellites to have GNSS system working, we need a correction source or a base station, and then we need a coordinate system.
Correct.
If we have these three things, we're able to start working.
Yep. And there and of course, the last and not the least important thing is to check and verify that your machine or your rover pole is actually matching the local coordinates. Easy done by just having a control point on the ground. You compare the coordinates you can get from the machine for the tool point with these coordinates. If these are matching with each other, then you know you're okay, you're ready to go.
How often should you do this verifying?
That depends a little bit. There's no rule of thumb, but let's say every time you change between different buckets, if you do any change to the machine, let's say you need to replace the teeth, or you need to change the cutting edge of the blade, I would definitely do it to verify. But also if you've been grading for a while, there is a wear and tear on the machine and on the tool. So I would say every now and then, if you do it more rough work, it will be probably more often because it will wear more on the machine. So it's a kind of a live situation. So at least once per week, that's a minimum. But I would recommend to do it every day.
Thank you very much, Anders. That was the end of this video where we have shown you how to work with coordinate systems, how to work with correction sources, and also how to work with GNSS satellite navigation. Thank you very much for watching.